to the Redskin. Go Redskin.
Good Redskin fans, and welcome back to another edition of Redskins Weekly. This week, I wanted to start by saying, if you hadn't had a chance to yet, make sure to go over and check out my other channel, HTTR for Life. I upload pretty much everything that I can't upload over here while I'm trying to get the channel monetized. Yeah, I was monetized for about 2 weeks, and they took my monetization back down because of a couple of videos that I had on the channel that were getting too many views. So I moved essentially everything off of the channel that was going to hinder anything and reapplied, jumping through their little hoops or whatnot. And I figure that this channel could just be the base of my podcast and maybe some of my reaction videos and the channel that I mainly go live from over here. While the other channel will be everything else, edited videos, maybe some interviews I might grab from here and there. Highlights, stuff from camp might be over there. Anything that might ring a third-party copyright or whatever, where somebody might put a claim on it, that's where I'm going to upload it from now on. If you hadn't had a chance yet, go over there and sub that channel up. I'm probably going to do things like once the podcast gets in season, I probably start taking cuts from the 30, 45-minute long podcasts and moving them over to that channel as 5 to 10 minute long teasers or 3 to 5 minute long teasers or whatever. Maybe good rants after a win or a loss or whatever the case may be. I'm probably going to upload it over there. And I will tell you that it does appear like that channel is getting a lot more response now after the draft and whatnot. Kind of feels like this channel here has gone stale after a while. I don't know. Maybe it's just me, but if you hadn't had a chance, go over there and sub that channel up. Definitely the next article I'm looking at is something that, at first kind of caught my eye. And then, I kind of shrugged it off like, happens every year. But then, of course, the first name that pops up was Sweat's name. And knowing that he's not signed is a little bit worrisome. But at the same time, not bothersome quite yet. Now, I understand why McLaurin hasn't signed yet. That's just the way that it generally works out for third round picks. So a lot of the verbiage is always off when it comes to those type of picks. There was a couple players that didn't sign until right before camp the last couple years since they went to these new contracts. So it's something to keep an eye on. I don't expect Sweat will stay unsigned for that long. But we'll find out within the coming days if he's going to sign or not. I know he's been out at rookie camp, and from what I've heard, he looks extremely good. So we'll see how that works out. That leads me right into the next story, which is from John Kime over here on ESPN, which is the only thing that I would read at ESPN. But it appears like Dwayne Haskins is fitting right in. I know that I heard Gruden talk, and Gruden basically said that he looked better throwing the ball on Friday than he did Saturday, but that he's still showing flashes of brilliance and he can't wait to get him, on the field with a full set of guys on both sides of the ball and see what the options are. I know that I've seen him throwing the ball, and yeah, it's a lot of one-on-ones. And then I saw a couple 7-on-7s, but they didn't really do a whole lot. So the good part about it is that he's fitting in. The kid's got a laser on his shoulder, and I see a lot of people, both for and against, really getting polarized with this particular player here. And I don't know if it's because of the number or what it is. It seems like it's old school versus new school with some of these arguments. But let's just give the kid a chance. I mean, we're Redskin fans. Let's see what he's got, I believe it's going to be an open competition in camp, whether we like it or whether we don't like it. Let's just give the kid an opportunity to come in and have the fans support him, and if he ends up the backup for a year, then he ends up the backup for a year. I personally don't think that's what's going to happen. I think he's going to win the job. You know, it just appears like there's already a media buzz on him, and you kind of want that somewhat with a quarterback, but you want a quarterback who can handle it. You know what I mean? You want a guy, and it's kind of a test when you first see them with the media, and he looks like he's doing a pretty good job with it thus far. We'll see how you know, that progresses forward, because we know that in season he'll be expected to talk to the media a couple times a week and directly after games, and things can get trying then. But this is a smart kid. I keep seeing comments on that other channel, and I'm going to tell you, man, I know I pointed this out in my last video over here, but I'm going to point it out again. There's some hateful people in this world. You guys need to relax a little. Go out on Saturday and hit the fishing hole or something, you know, like if you like to drink beer, sip a couple beers, man, like relax. Life is too short to stay so angry at certain things, you know, and things move forward in life, you know. But I'm excited to see what this kid can bring. As I've already said, if it's a year on the bench, then so be it. You know, I know Case Keenum has been a starter in the league before, so in my opinion, he's got the foot up so far. Colt McCoy knows the playbook, but at the same time, you know, where is Colt McCoy going to be in the in terms of health? I love seeing this article right here. This is from Redskins.com, but I love seeing this article right here. I watched Jarrett play at Virginia Tech, and I fell in love with the way he played. And then when we drafted him, I was hype. I'm not even gonna lie, I can't think of any word but hype. And the guy really brings something to the field that I enjoyed watching as a fan. So I can't think of another word but stoked at the idea of him being able to come in and coach these guys who are basically his age or maybe a couple years younger, and be able to connect with them immediately. He's in a perfect position to be able to step in and give something back. And I think he's going to be a hell of a coach. You know, everybody seems really impressed with his knowledge of, you know, how things work, you know, and just stepping out of playing a couple years ago, you know, everything's still fresh in his mind. He knows a lot about the current, you know, schemes in the NFL. He knows a lot about the current players in the NFL. It's just a good thing. And, you know, a couple of stories I've seen pop out have talked lately about how he's transitioned from the thought of playing football again to being hired as, I believe he's the what do they hire him as? The quality control assistant or something like that? Here it is, defensive quality control coach, which is a bantam title, so to speak. I think he'll be the secondary coach eventually. But it was good to see this guy, you know, get a second chance. He was willing to do anything as a player. I even saw him slide the nickel back that year. And I was really, you know, hyped about what he was going to bring to the future. You know, being a Hokie fan, I sometimes get accused of being a homer. But I try to tell folks and I try to point players out and say, look, we need to grab that guy. We need to grab that guy. And a lot of times our teams decide not to. And then we end up kicking ourselves in the rear because a couple of years down the road, and we still need this player, we still need that player. I mean, Cam Chancellor is a perfect example. I said that we should have picked him up in the fourth or fifth round. He slid to the seventh. There was a lot of questions about was he going to play middle linebacker, or, you know, was he a safety? People thought maybe he wasn't fast enough to play safety. Case closed. But I know that he just got released by Seattle the other day. You know, he's got a neck injury, I believe. But still, you know, I know Virginia Tech just – their 24 or 25 year run just ended with players in the draft, but generally every year we have a few of them. I think the year before we had like 11. So you know, I expect more to be coming in the future. You know, I don't read a whole lot from 106.7, but when I saw this come through on a Google alert, I decided to put it in the rotation here on this particular episode. And this is something that I've been hoping for a while. You know, that they needed to hire some sort of consultant or next-gen developers or whatever to try to look at the injury setup and figure out what is going on with the Redskins. I mean, 2 years in a row, they've had the most injuries in the NFL. You know, in my opinion, and I'm sure a lot of people's that that maybe probably listening or probably that are out there, you know, is that something's got to be amiss here, you know, to have 2 years in a row of being the most hurt team. And then not to mention that there was like maybe a year or two before that where we were really banged up, but the Cardinals were so beat up that, you know, that was the only reason why we weren't the most beat up team. So it's good to see the team looking for an outside answer. You know, it really caught me out there when the team won the Ed Block Courage Award for the best training staff. It just made me stop, you know, full path, like, whoa. I couldn't believe it. And that's because with all those injuries, it makes me think that that falls back on the training staff after 2 years. So, you know, and all the Redskins guys keep saying is how great their staff is, that people come to them for second opinions. So, hey, that be the case, then, you know, call me wrong, and I'm glad that they're trying to look for an alternative, you know, option. Maybe it'll lead to something that gets our players healthier as the seasons go, right? I mean, it can't hurt. But Michael Phillips of the Richmond Times-Dispatch went on to say, one thing I will tell you, Bruce Allen and the Redskins were so concerned about this, they hired outside consultants to come into the building this offseason and examine everything about the way the Redskins handle injuries, top down, top to bottom. Gave them full latitude to the building, ask questions, do whatever you want. So I can tell you that while it is still happening, that's bad, there's at least a general awareness that this is bad and this is not normal. So yes, they are asking the questions. I don't know that they're receiving answers that anybody would deem satisfactory or that are changing the course of things, but I can tell you that it is on the radar, and yes, they spent a little bit of Mr. Snyder's money looking into that. So, you know, certain things are great to see, and this is one of them. Hopefully they figure something out. You know, I saw this article, and it's so good to see positive stuff rolling around, and I wanted to point it out. And I see a lot of community stuff that doesn't see the light of day in the mainstream. And I think that I'm in the future, when I get this stuff, I'm going to start posting it here in this section. And I believe that I can do that. But yeah, when I start getting those memos about, you know, the charity organizations and the weekly coach of the week or whatever for a local high school that they pick, I think it's all across the DMV area, I'm going to start posting a lot of that stuff here in this particular section. But I always like to see them get people giving back. And to see this brings a smile to my face. A lot of people involved with this particular organization that do good work. And it's good to see the Redskins get involved with something like this that's positive. And we all know Doc Walker's a stand-up dude. So who else could be involved but him, right? I saw this article a few days ago, and I realized this is from last weekend, but it was talking about how we boasted multiple players on PFF's draft steal list. And I love that, by the way. The one that's always caught my eye, and it's caught theirs as well, which is why I wanted to show this article, which their site here doesn't load very good. But Kelvin Harmon. I mean, we got him at pick 206. I think this guy is going to be a massive steal. I mean, when you look at his size and his, I know his speed has been questioned, but, you know, I was talking to somebody in the comments about this, and I apologize for not remembering their name right offhand. But 4.6 speed isn't necessarily slow. It just isn't lightning fast. You know, and at 6.3, y'all can keep doubting him all you want. But, and I love the fact that he picked number 13. I love that. We get him at 206, and he has number one receiver potential, you know, and that's remarkable that you get him at pick 206, where backup tackles are leading to, you know, players that are the first people to get cut. And we got this guy who could be a future star. Now, then again, he, you know, the future is not told, but hey, weapons. And rookie camp, he's shown a lot of the tracking skills he has And it is one-on-one, which favors the receiver. But we'll see what he's got further into camp and see what he can bring to the field. We're going to have a young receiving core this year. You're probably going to see a lot of players that, you know, that you don't, you have to look twice and say, what number is he? Who is that? But Kelvin Harmon is a guy to keep your eye on. You know, I saw this article earlier this week and it caught my eye because it really is a good question. Is tight end a problem or a production problem? And basically it goes on to talk about, and J.P. Finley wrote this, but it goes on to talk about how they owe nearly $19 million to the tight end position, highest of any NFL club between Jordan Reed, Vernon Davis, and Jeremy Sprinkle, which is unreal if you go and really think about it. But a lot of it's because Jordan Reed's getting paid an unbelievable amount of money, because by this point in time, the Redskins front office thought he would be getting 1,000-yard receiving years and multiple touchdowns, hopefully, you know, the double-digit area, and staying healthy for 16 games. Now, that appears to be something that might not ever happen for Reed. And that truly does suck, but I hope that maybe them bringing the next-gen people in or whatever to trying to assess the injury issue will lead to something good for Reed. But at the same time, he's been through a lot of concussions now. What is it, like 6 or 7 he's had since college? I know he had 2 of them in college, I think. I believe it's 5 with the Redskins. And then he's had every kind of problem that you could think of, from elbows to ankles to – I don't think he's had any knee problems, but anybody that hears me or hears me say that and sees that I'm wrong could point that out. But I would think that this set of guys here should be – you know, the Redskins, we always thought that Jordan Reed was always the Redskins' number one receiver. And that was the reason why they didn't invest other places. And I see the team is now going young and looking to other options. You know, this time next year, Jordan Reed might not even be a Redskin. The team might cut him at this point next year. It'll be good to keep an eye on this. And Vernon Davis is getting older. I believe Vernon Davis is 34 this year, 35 maybe. I believe he makes like $6 million a year, which is not chump change for a tight end. He's still a specimen, and I know he's lost a step. But I think he's decent enough to be able to garner another at least 2 years out of him, or at least another year out of him. Like, this guy is, you know, when other guys hit his age, they generally start falling off. Well, this guy has lost a step, but he's still a physical specimen and dominant. And can do it across the field, too. I noticed last year he turned the burners on a couple times and was gone. I saw this article earlier in the week, and it's by Peter Haley over there at CSN. And it was talking about the 3 weakest spots and how they can make the positions better. Now, I'm not going to get into where, you know, the article goes, but it's talking about tight end, which we just talked about, safety opposite of Collins, and the left guard. Now, I'm going to tell you, those 3 spots are definitely a question area. Now, I just went over tight end, so let's move right into the safety opposite of Collins. I still have no clue what's going to happen at that spot. The only thing I can think of is maybe Troy Apke could be a guy that they're thinking can move into that spot and play it. I don't know why they would think that completely yet, because of, you know, there's really no evidence to prove it. And DeShazer Everett is still there, but I mean, Everett is still, to me, a special teams guy. He's just not the guy you're looking for. When I think of a guy that's going to play center field, it's not Everett. Some people talk about Trey Boston, which hasn't happened. There's got to be a reason why that's not happening, by the way. Maybe the team would transition Jimmy Moreland over to free safety. That would be interesting. Maybe if Jimmy Moreland won the spot at free safety, after all of the picks he had at James Madison, that would be interesting to see if that actually were to happen. I know that he has range and he has ball skills and he has speed. You know, the hype is not really there from coming from a smaller school, but I know the team because I'm a VA head and I'm also a VA homer with everything except for UVA. But when it comes to that, that would be interesting to keep an eye on. And we don't know if maybe a couple of the undrafted rookies might, you know, come in and step in. Every year seems like there's at least one or two that make the team and surprise everybody. It'd be nice if it came from that particular position group. Now, left guard, I'm not certain what's going to happen here. It'd be, in an ideal situation, either Wes Martin or Eric Flowers would step in and take the position. Ideally, you honestly would rather probably have Wes Martin do it. We know that Flowers is a bust, you know, playing tackle, so we do not want him playing our swing tackle spot. But at the same time, we don't necessarily want to have to pay him big-time dollars next year to come back and play for us when we already have a rookie. And we have Ross Pierschbacher, who could be a left guard, primarily played as a center last when he was with Alabama in college, but he also played left guard. Both of those guys are leaders. So it'll be interesting to see where this position battle ends. Right now, it would look like there's several players that are going to be involved in it. It's just good to see the team finally move on from Sean Laval. I'm just unbelievably happy about that. So we'll see which direction they go with it. This article here is a little bit older, but it was something that I missed in last week's session. And it goes on to talk about Sheldrick Redwine and Sean Taylor's dad, and how he kind of helped out training this kid. And it goes on to tell a story about Sean Taylor giving him an autograph through someone and how they still have it at his house. And, you know, he's kept it for all this time. Basically, says, like he says, I don't have it framed. It's just sitting there. We won't lose it, though. And, you know, it goes on to talk about how he feels, how they felt when Sean died. But when I read this section down here, which I think you guys should check out if you got a chance, but Pete Taylor, who I'm actually somewhat friends with, somewhat cordial with, it talked about how it was therapy to watch the younger guys play and everything, and it was just a really good read. If you have a chance, check it out. It's over on Cleveland.com. I'm not going to get fully into it because it doesn't really affect the Redskins, but if you check that out. And when I saw this, I thought to myself, you know, I've been telling everybody for the longest time, Colt McCoy's days as a Redskin quarterback are numbered. You know, the question to me is, will the Redskins ask him to be a coach? Because I highly doubt he gets picked up after having this many surgeries on his leg. And if he were to, you know, end up being a third string quarterback with the Redskins, I guess he could go one more year as a third string quarterback. It's paying a lot of money for a third string quarterback. I think he makes like $3.5 million, which is the exact same thing we're paying for Case as the backup, or both of them, I should say, as backups. So I don't know. Maybe that in there lies another question. You know, should the Redskins go with two quarterbacks or three? I think they learned last year that they should possibly go with three. And we know that Alex Smith is shut down at least for the first like 9 weeks, probably longer. And Colt will not be going and doing anything until at least training camp. And the thought of Colt just getting back on the field after training or at training camp is not real, you know, it doesn't sit really good with me. You know, it doesn't make me think, well, that guy could be, you know, our starter. It really doesn't. It doesn't make me feel warm and fuzzy at night, you know? I honestly want it to be an open competition. I want Haskins to have his opportunity. I want Case to get his opportunity. And if Colt is healthy, he'll get his opportunity. I can't remember the kid's name that we picked up from the AAF, but he, to me, is nothing but a camp body. And, you know, that's just the way I look at it. Alex Smith is not going to be there at camp as far as playing. He'll be there to teach. And I do see him being able to help out almost like in a coach type situation, all the guys that are healthy and that are going to play. I think mainly they need to stick him with Case and Dwayne, but we'll see how that works out. But I think this is just another sign, you know, maybe that Colt should start thinking about his future, which could be But maybe he could even play as a player coach this year. Third string quarterbacks don't tend to dress on Sunday. And it just seems like a lot of money to pay a guy to not dress every week. So we'll see how this works out. But Colt McCoy may have put the jersey on for the last time. We'll see. A lot of people think that because he knows the system that he'll be back and definitely have a spot in the offense. I'm not so certain. We're going to see how it works out, though. When I saw this article, it's been 6-7 days ago when I saw it. And I wanted to point it out to everybody. If you got a chance to come over here and check out this interview they had with him, and you could see that this kid's got a good head on his shoulders. And I enjoyed reading this. Now, some of the stuff that was asked of him is just basic stuff. But there are two questions and answers that I really wanted to look at real quick. And the first one was, afterward on the teleconference with reporters, someone asked you how you had 18 career interceptions, to which you answered, "Because I'm a dog." Where did that answer come from? His answer was, "Ha, I don't know. I don't know. It was a quick little moment. I was so hyped, but that moment, I was built into this coming from where I came from. A few barely make it out, and that turned me into the person I am today. Guess that line comes from that." And the next one was, you returned 5 career interceptions for touchdowns. How were you so successful taking them back for a score? And his answer was, in high school, I played every position, quarterback, receiver, really every position besides O-line and D-line. So I always had the vision of the field to see how players were set up. Once you get a pick, it's easy because most of the people don't think you'll get an interception. Then most of the people are reacting off you getting an interception. So basically, once you get one and return it, the only thing you have to get past is the lineman and quarterback. Our defensive coordinator at JMU always told us, once somebody gets the interception, to block the intended receiver and quarterback, because I can outrun any lineman. So that's where I get my return skills from. It's good to see comments like that. And as I was pointing out a little while ago, I'm really thinking that this guy could play safety. He played a little bit of safety during his college career. Wouldn't it be good if we could transition this guy to a free safety? He is 5'10". He is 178 pounds, 180 pounds. But if we could transition him to a safety somehow, I know that's a little light. More like, I imagine everybody's probably thinking more like a nickel guy. But just imagine the possibilities, the ball hawking ability of this kid. We'll see how that works out. It's great to see this kid's got a good head on his shoulders and that he's directed at doing big things. And I love to see that, the little dog in him. I like to see it. Now, this article here is a definite catch for everybody that wants to know something about this kid. I can tell you, I was impressed by Bryce Love and the way that he did things on the field looking at his highlights. After reading this article, I'm ready to see what he brings to the field now. He talks about how over the last year, he's concentrated more on pass protection and things that make him an all-around back, like watching things down the field, becoming a better receiver, just a lot of different things, a lot of different qualities. This is a must-read for anybody out there looking to learn more about this player. He goes into depth about a lot of things that I was quite impressed about. It's a bright kid, and he wants to be the best back ever. Thinking that he's going to be Chris Thompson's replacement and be able to play behind AP and with Geis, good Lord. If this guy makes it, we're going to have a really good backfield. But check this article out. It's on the Players Tribune. The next article I'm going to look at is from over here on FanSpeak. And he's talking about, some free agents that the Redskins should consider on the offensive side of the ball. And the very first one right off the bat is Pierre Garçon. And I can tell you, I am in 100% agreement with this. Now, as long as Garçon would be willing to come to us for a much lowered contract off of what he was making the last few years in San Francisco, I believe this could be something that could be a match made in heaven for Haskins or Case Keenum, whoever ends up winning the quarterback battle. But he also talked about Dontrell Inman, who Inman has already signed with the Patriots now. Of course, he didn't know that when he put this article out. And then he goes on to say that Lee Smith was somebody they could pick up as a tight end. Levine Tuilolo, I guess that's what that is. I hope I didn't butcher his name. I seem to remember seeing his name sometime before. And then he goes on to talk about interior offensive linemen. And I agree with both of those if they were to be somebody they could get in. I'm not so sure about Marshall Newhouse. I guess that could be somebody that could be thought of as maybe a swing tackle. We're still looking for our replacement at Ty Nsekhe, and I think Steve's trying to figure out who that's going to be. Right at the moment, we don't have one. So I could see his point there with Newhouse. I'm not sure that's really the direction we should head in with Newhouse unless we can get him for dirt cheap. But nevertheless, the next article I want to look at is a little article talking about Montez Sweat and how he could be a Julius Peppers redo. And I really enjoy this particular blog. They are very straightforward with their opinions and open and not biased towards a certain team or anything to that nature. And I enjoy their breakdowns. And it goes to talk about, you know, about his size and how many sacks he's had. And then it shows some of the, you know, the breakdown of film of his. And I can tell you, if you didn't already know about Sweat, this guy is a freak. But, you know, his speed is going to cause some issues. Some people were saying that, you know, basically he's like a safety defensive end or linebacker, which is just completely nuts. And his strength is off the chart, too. So, you know, it's going to be interesting to see what the Redskins are able to do with this guy, with the defensive line that we already have, with Kerrigan on the other side, you know, with Ryan Anderson in the mix as well. You know, it's going to be interesting to see what exactly is going to happen. Teams are going to have to adjust. You know, if Ryan Kerrigan's getting double teams now, imagine what's going to happen when Sweat's coming in at 4.3, you know, 40 speed. You know, the kid has got closing speed. Quarterbacks should be fearful of this kid. Now, I realize that the speed of the game itself is going to take a little bit for him to get adjusted to, and that's what it is. You know, I like to see the things being said about him with the constant motor. And, you know, I really don't know how this kid made it out of the top 10, but I'm thankful that we were able to trade back into the first round and pick this kid up as late as we did. You know, we get him at a discounted rate. You know, we at least get him for 4 years. The fifth year option will definitely not be something that will, you know, break us like it might have with other players. And it's great to know that, you know, we're heading in a positive direction when it comes to the defensive side of the ball. You know, I know that there's still a lot of question marks with the offense, but I feel like the plethora of talent that we have and the youth that we have right now, that the offense has nowhere to go but ascend forward. You know, I know that some people want Jay Gruden fired. I tell you, though, they're not going to start the year off with the thought of, you know, let's do what we can do to lose games, or, you know, they're going to play the best talent and they're going to try to win every game they can. It's not going to be a losing fest. I know some Redskin fans want that to happen. You probably should go ahead and stop yourself from that, because this organization is never going to just flop. I mean, I know that we've been stuck in the 7-9 rut and it feels like we're just trapped, but you keep bringing in young talent and eventually it's going to pay off all the way down the road. We can just break the injury bug. This team is really poised to really make a move in the standings. It'll be interesting to see how things work out with the two first-round picks this year. A lot of, you know, discussion back and forth amongst fans about whether or not how much playing time these guys are going to see. I think they both might start day one. So, you know, anyway, this is a really, really good breakdown here. And as you see, it's not, you know, it's not some short breakdown either. It's really got some depth to it. Go check it out if you can. It's called MattWaldmanRSP.com. And he does breakdowns of a lot of different players. The last article I want to talk about was from Hogshaven. And I can tell you, folks, it sticks and resonates into the theories and thought patterns that I've had about the wide receiver position all year long. And I keep telling people that Cam Sims is the guy that can step in and do things. You know, this guy had a high ankle sprain last year. And that high ankle sprain cost him his entire 2018 season. He was ready to go and play again by week three, but the team never reactivated him. And it always made me question why, because I believe he had led all receivers in receiving yards and catches and everything in the preseason. Now I realize that that's also just preseason, so I'm not putting a lot of weight into it. But to know that he has the ability and the skill set of what we're looking for, I mean, you know, he's a big kid. This kid's 6'5". You know, he can do a whole lot across the middle, and I'm really pumped to see what he brings to the field. And he has become the forgotten Redskin, as the article goes to point out. And if we can get this guy rolling and match him up with what we already have, and maybe somehow or another get Doxson going too, this team could really take off quick. Now, I don't know which direction it'll head in terms of, is the offense going to be more of a stretch the field type of team, or if they're going to be, you know, a screen pass heavy, you know, kind of setup. I know that a lot of times, a lot of coaches try to dumb down everything for a rookie quarterback. I'm not so certain that happens in Haskins' situation, though, because Haskins is not a dumb quarterback. So, you know, we'll see how that works out. And anybody that thinks that Haskins is not smart, they really should check themselves and go check out a couple of things, some film, see him breaking down film before you share that opinion any further, because you're only making yourself look like a fool. Now, that's the last article I got for this week, but I could tell you that it really wasn't a big, you know, heavy article week, being the fact that we had rookie training camp this weekend. I'm expecting a lot of articles in the next couple of days to really talk about what the team looked like, you know, the rookies looked like in their first, you know, encounter with Redskin football over this weekend. And I can tell you from what I've seen and what I've heard that they all looked pretty good. And the receivers that came out looked really good. Steven Sims Jr. was somebody, the name that stuck out. McLaren was a name that stuck out. Dwayne Haskins, you know, Montez Sweat, Jordan Brailford. These guys are really going to be players that, you know, to keep an eye on as things progress throughout the year. Right now, yeah, they're not in pads, and so, you know, it's just something to watch, and it's something to get them kind of more used to the system. Want to thank everybody again for tuning in, but that's about all I got. Hail to the Redskins, y'all. Peace.